Welcome to the 354th episode of the Reading and Writing Podcast. Stay tuned for my interview with New York Times bestselling author M.O. Walsh, author of the new novel, The Big Door Prize. And stay tuned after the interview for a short excerpt from the audiobook of The Big Door Prize by M.O. Walsh. Stay tuned for the interview. The Reading and Writing Podcast is brought to you by Libro FM. Libro.fm lets you purchase audiobooks directly from your favorite local bookstore. You can pick from more than 185,000 audiobooks, including bestsellers and recommendations from booksellers. You'll get the same audiobooks at the same price as the largest audiobook company out there, but you'll be part of a different story. One that supports your local community and your local bookstore. If you're new to audiobooks, they're the perfect way to get more books into your busy life. You can listen during your commute, while doing chores, walking the dog, or just relaxing at home. All you need is a smartphone and the free Libro.fm app. If you already love audiobooks and don't know what to listen to next, check out recommendations and curated lists from people who know audiobooks best, your local bookseller. Here's your special offer from the Reading and Writing Podcast. Get two audiobooks for the price of one today with your first month of membership with the code RWPODCAST at checkout. This offer is only valid for new members in Canada and the U.S. Check out Libro.fm today. Welcome back to the Reading and Writing Podcast. My guest today is M.O. Walsh, author of the new novel, The Big Door Prize. Walsh's first novel, My Sunshine Away, was a New York Times bestseller and winner of the Pat Conroy Southern Book Prize. His fiction and essays have appeared in the New York Times, The Guardian, Oxford American, The Southern Review, American Short Fiction, and Best New American Voices, among others. M.O., welcome to the podcast.
Well, thanks. It's great to be here.
Great. Well, if someone hasn't heard about your new novel, The Big Door Prize, yet, how would you describe the novel?
Well, I can tell you what it's about. It's set in a small Louisiana town, a fictional town called Deerfield, Louisiana. Small enough to where, you know, everybody kind of goes to the same grocery store, all that, knows everybody, all that type of stuff. And the novel kicks off with the appearance of a sort of strange machine at the grocery store that no one's ever seen. Looks sort of like a photo booth, you know, just sits there next to the Coinstar machine. But what this machine promises to do is if you give it a sample of your DNA, a little cheek swab, and put it in there, it analyzes it and can tell the person sort of what their utmost potential is, sort of what their body and mind are capable of doing if everything would have worked out just right in life, right? And so the people in this town, you know, just sort of start trying it. And the first few people that get these readouts, it's like a little blue ticket that comes out that usually just has like one word on it as to what you could be. They start trying it. And like one of the first people gets one that says entrepreneur. Right. And so it's sort of a strange readout, but she goes and she quits her job and opens up a little snowball stand in town and it starts doing really well. And so people start, you know, thinking maybe there's something to this. And the next thing you know, almost everybody in the town is trying it. And it's really the heart of the novel is about a married couple who are very happily married, been together for, a long time. And they each try this machine and get readouts that send them sort of emotionally in very different directions, you know, just sort of make them see their future lives differently than they did before. And so that's sort of the heart of it. That's the main thing you follow. But it's a novel that's full of characters. I mean, you know, the town is one of the main characters and sort of what's happening to all these people as they get these glimpses into a new sort of vision of themselves. And if they like it, if they want to pursue it or some of the people don't like what this machine tells them. So it follows that as well. I mean, ultimately, it sounds sort of sci-fi, I guess, but really it's more of a kind of comic and I think funny and sad Southern novel.
And do you remember what was the original idea or impetus that led you to write The Big Door Prize?
Yeah, man, I had the idea for this probably like 15 years ago or so. I'd written a short story with the same premise that really only followed those two characters, and it was, you know, maybe 15 pages long or something. But whenever, you know, normally when I write a story and it gets published, I don't really think about it anymore. It's sort of, you know, in the past. But this was an idea that just never went away. And so, you know, I wrote my first novel, My Sunshine Away. It took me like 7 years to do. And when I was finished with that, I just sort of took about a year just kind of thinking what I wanted to do next. And that idea just never left me. And My Sunshine Away is sort of a dark novel, you know, more contemplative. And I wanted to try something new. And so I immediately saw, you know, some comic possibility in this and something, an idea for maybe a book that's a little bit lighter and actually was a lot of fun to write. So that's sort of what happened.
Well, the idea that you described, I mean, sounds somewhat kind of like a high concept. I'm curious, has there been any interest from Hollywood?
There's some TV interest, yes. But I can't talk too much about it yet.
Sure,
But
sure.
yeah, that's an exciting idea. Yeah.
That's great. Well, the title of the novel originally caught my eye, and I wasn't sure until I read a little bit more. But the title of the novel comes from a John Prine song, and also the chapter titles are drawn from John Prine songs. How did Prine and his work influence the novel, The Big Door Prize?
Yeah, well, I've been a fan of his for I guess about 20 years or so. Once my wife actually introduced me to his work when back when we were dating, when we were first started dating, and I never heard of him, and started listening to him. And at that time, I liked him mainly because his songs were easy to play, and I was learning how to play guitar, and I was like, oh, I could do this, and so I started playing it. And then over the, you know, ensuing decades, I quickly realized that he was absolutely one of my favorite writers in the world. It didn't matter what the, you know, fiction, you know, poetry, songwriting, he was at the top. I just love so much about the way he approaches storytelling, and about the way he sort of sees the world, which to me is always, you know, even though he has a lot of songs that are sad, they're honest and sad. They're not sad just for effect. They're sad because some things in life are sad. But a lot of his songs seem to have this sort of wink in them. You know, he's got some funny lines in there. And he always seems to be able to see the humanity in people. And so whenever I was writing this book, I was about a year or so in before I had any sort of connection at all to his music. And what happened for me was, you know, I had my storyline. I was working on my characters. But I think all novels, at least in my experience, there comes a point where you realize, okay, I need to find some sort of overall structure to kind of put on top of this. I need to find like what's the ultimate tone of the book? I mean, because you can just sit there and write characters and write scenes forever, but until you sort of know what's my goal here, it's hard, right? You just feel like you're just out in a field, you know, just kind of wandering around. And what I knew I wanted from this book was a book that, you know, did all the things that he did, and a book that celebrates, you know, our humanity and celebrates, you know, love. I mean, he's got a song called "The Glory of True Love." You know, as sappy as it sounds, when you write like he does and you're honest about it, you can earn, you know, things that sound like cliches, right? And so, like, that's what I love about him. When John Prine sings about the glory of true love, you believe it. You know, he says, "Old Faithful is just a fountain compared to the glory of true love," right? He's got a way of just making the world, at least to me, one worth living in, right? And so that was, once I realized that, I was like, you know what I'm going for? I'm spending all these years here trying to match the tone of John Prine's music, which has been so important to me, and sort of trying to pay back, I think, in some ways through fiction, what he's, you know, paid to me in song. And so once that happened, I was sitting there, I was writing one scene. There's a scene with the principal of the school who she does this this readout machine, and hers says carpenter. And I just wrote the line, you know, she just says, "Well, you know, my grandpa was a carpenter." And as soon as I wrote that, I was like, wow. I was like, you know, I'm like, there might be something to this. And so I went back and I started looking at the chapters, and I was like, you know, there's a John Prine lyric for almost every situation in life. And sure enough, once I started thinking about it that way, I could find, you know, little snippets of lines of his to match almost every single chapter in the book. And then ultimately, I think In Spite of Ourselves, which is where the title comes from, the chorus of that song, it's one of my favorite songs of all time. It was me and my wife's wedding song. I just think it's such a remarkable love song that celebrates how strange and we all are, but yet how lucky we are to find another strange person to share our lives with. And so that was it. Once I had that idea, I went for it.
And sadly, we lost Prine several months ago. I'm curious, before he passed, was he aware of your manuscript and your novel?
No, unfortunately not. You know, I've never met him in life. And it was sort of my dream that, you know, maybe one day he would hold this book and, you know, just sort of know what he's meant to me and my family and, you know, and how fondly I think of his work. I'd actually written a letter and we were in the process of packaging up a book with my letter to send to him. That was in April and he died April 7th. So it never made it to him.
Gosh. So what are your earliest memories of writing fiction?
My earliest memories are probably, high school. I can remember, you know, the way I always think about it is, you know, people always ask like, when did you know you were sort of a writer? To me, I think I knew that I was different than my friends in like, you know, fifth grade or so when we would go to English class, you know, and our teacher would get up there and read Edgar Allan Poe or something. And we'd leave the class and all my friends would be making fun of him. And I was thinking, that's like the coolest thing I've ever heard in my life. I loved it. And so from an early age, I knew I had a sort of different relationship than most of my friends did to stories, right? And to reading stories. And then I remember in high school, maybe freshman year, I had a class where, you know, as part of our English class, they were like, why don't you write you write your own short story. And so I think a lot of my friends did this in like, you know, 20 minutes after school that day. And I just went home and I wrote this story that was just like really dark. And I still remember it. It's about a person like breaking into someone's house to masturbate under their bed. It was like really dark and twisted. And this elicited.
I'm sure your teacher loved that.
Well, it elicited a call from my teacher to my mom saying, hey, you might want to keep an eye on your son's imagination. But it was, you know, to be honest, I recognized, I think at that point that I got some sort of attention for it, you know? And not only that, but I also just realized I really liked it. I mean, you know, in college I took workshops and all that stuff and really loved it. Then I went to get a master's degree because I thought I wanted to be like a literature professor, you know, I wanted to get a master's and a PhD and do all that. But I quickly realized in graduate school that I liked making stuff up way more than I liked researching stuff. And so that shifted gears from after my master's, I went and got an MFA where you could just really, you know, dive in to producing much more so than commenting, on the canon. And so that was great for me. It's always been the thing I love. Even though I think work is hard, I'm never sitting there just, you know, typing a million words a minute thing. And this is great. You know, I mean, it's always sort of a struggle. But the thing I've realized, you know, I'm in my 40s now that I've realized about the last 20 years of my life doing this is that I sort of feel the best about myself kind of while I'm working. You know, I mean, time works in a weird way and I just enjoy it. Like I'll look up at the screen and it's been, you know, 4 hours. And I'm like, man, that was such a great 4 hours, you know, just wandering this made up world, even if it's frustrating. It's just, I don't know. I feel good during those times.
Well, you just mentioned your MFA and I know you attended the University of Mississippi for your MFA. What was that experience like for you?
Well, I mean, for me, it's hard to overstate the way that it changed me and my writing. I would not at all be the writer I am today. And I don't even mean being good. I just mean even stylistically without going to that school. And so my experience was, like I said, I was getting a master's at the University of Tennessee. I knew that I didn't want to keep doing that. And I had a professor there named Michael Knight, who's a really fine fiction writer, say, well, you should go get an MFA. And I didn't even really know that much about him at the time. He was like, well, they just started one at University of Mississippi that a guy named Barry Hanna is running. And I didn't know who Barry Hanna was at that time. And I told him that and he looked at me like I was the biggest idiot he had ever seen in his life. And he handed me a copy of a book called Airships and said, go home and read this right now. And so I did. I mean, I can still remember laying on my bed in Knoxville, Tennessee, reading Airships for the first time. And I applied like the next, you know, that next week to Ole Miss. And luckily for me, they were just starting that program at that time. I mean, if I applied now, I probably wouldn't get in. It's really a remarkable program now. But the timing was just right. And so I got there and, you know, was very nervous to have a class with this guy. And my first class was with Barry Hanna, and he immediately sort of eviscerated all my stories. And so it was, you know, I don't think things still operate this way. I mean, I think that workshops these days are a little bit more careful with people's egos, but he was not with mine. And in a way, it was like the best thing that ever happened to me. Because at the time I was writing a lot of really sort of, you know, theoretical, you know, vague fiction that really was just interested in itself and how, you know, weird it could be.
O'Reilly. This is Derek's O'Reilly Auto Parts story.
After the third time jump-starting my car, I finally realized my battery was dying. So I stopped by O'Reilly to have it checked. They tested it right there in the parking lot. It was bad, real bad. But they helped me find the right battery for my car and even installed it for free. Now my car starts like new. Oh, 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 O'Reilly
Auto Parts. With no fees or minimums on checking and savings accounts, banking with Capital One is like the easiest decision in the history of decisions. Kind of like choosing Charles Barkley in a pickup game.
We'll take Barkley.
Ha! First pick! Sorry, kids!
Yep, even easier than that. And with our top-rated app, you can bank anytime, anywhere, making Capital One an even easier decision.
Okay, here's the plan. Pass me the ball every time.
This is banking reimagined. What's in your wallet?
New consumer accounts only. Approval required. Terms apply. Capital One N.A. member FDIC.
And my teachers there, like Barry, I had Tom Franklin, Brad Watson. They sort of let me know, like, look, you can't just keep doing this and be vague. You have to like strip it down and like write a sentence that makes sense. I mean, you have to start with just subject, verb, object. Let's just do that first, right? And let's see where we can go. And so stylistically, I had to like really, really strip it down and almost like start to learn sentences all over again. And when I look at my work now, I realize what a huge influence that was on me, because there's nothing I care about more now than being clear. That's the main thing. I mean, if I have one goal, it is to be clear. And that would not have happened without them. You know, I think another thing that happens in an MFA program is you start reading contemporary writers. You know, I think in college, all I read was, you know, the Faulkners and the, you know, all the people that are sort of, you know, in the canon. Right. And then I get to my MFA and you meet not only professors, but other students who are big readers. And so that was around the time like when George Saunders just had like Civil War Land and Bad Decline and Pastoralia coming out. Adam Johnson's first book, Emporium, was out. You know, I got, you know, there were just all sorts of books that were happening now that I got to read. Amy Bender, The Girl in the Flammable Skirt. Books like that just broke me open. And it was the type of thing where I was like, wow, this is the conversation I'm really in. I'm not in a conversation, you know, with people that have been dead for 100 years. I'm not in a conversation even with Carver or anybody like that. You know, if I want to write now, I'm in a conversation with people that are putting books out right now. And so that was really helpful in that way as well.
Well, you teach writing at the University of New Orleans currently. I'm sure you have lots of thoughts about writing, but what advice would you offer for those who are listening, who are writing their own stories and novels?
Well, yeah, I mean, there's a ton, you know, and sometimes that's the problem. You know, sometimes I tell my students, you know, if all you're doing is reading a different craft essay, you're reading like 5 craft essays a week, you're not going to get anywhere, because all you're doing is getting a bunch of different advice that lots of times is sort of in conflict with other advice. Right. So I think it's good to read a little bit of that stuff. But then what you really have to do, and everyone's going to tell you this, is you got to read other books, first of all, not craft essays, but other books. You got to find out what you like, and then start thinking about why do you like it. And then once you do that, you start thinking about, okay, well, what kind of book do I want to write? What book do I think like needs to be in the world, right? But as far as the actual writing advice, I would have 2 sort of practical things, right? The first one is what I was saying earlier. You know, your job as a writer is to make, you know, a stranger see something, you know, only using the alphabet, which is a pretty strange thing. And so there's lots of things that are really hard about fiction writing. But some things are easy. Okay. And the easy thing is to write a sentence, that is straightforward and clear, is not overcomplicated. Anytime you can do something that's easy, like, for example, a clause like the next Tuesday, comma, right? Do that. Do the easy thing. Okay. Because there's so much about writing that's hard. When you can do something easy, take advantage of it. Okay. So that's one thing. And the other thing would be, it's not as practical, it's, I guess, a little bit more philosophical, but what I find most writers do, and when they're just starting out, and what I did forever, was just sort of try to copy the people I liked, right? So if I read a Barry Hannah story, for instance, since we mentioned him earlier, I would go try to write a story that sounded like him. And ultimately, it would fail every time, right? If I read, it doesn't matter. Pick it out. If I go try to copy it, it doesn't work. Okay. So even though I know there's always a short sort of apprentice, phase where you're sort of copying styles and things, whenever it's time for you to write your book, the thing that you have to do is recognize that, everyone can write if they sit down and practice it. Right. I mean, my kids are in 8 and 12 years old. They can write. Okay. But the thing that's going to make your book interesting and make people want to read it is if you recognize that the most interesting thing about you is that there's no one else on the planet exactly like you. Okay. That's the advantage that you have. And that's the only one, right? So what you need to do is fully embrace who you are in all of its strangeness and all of its contradictions, and all of it. And that's really the only chance you have, because just writing, people can learn it, right? But no one can be you. And it takes, I think, a long time for a lot of writers to fully sort of believe in themselves and trust their ideas. And that would be my advice. You got to do it, because no one's looking for the next Faulkner, right? They're looking for the new you. And so you got to embrace it.
And so are you still writing short stories as well as your novels?
Not as often. I think I've maybe written like 2 stories in like the last 4 or 5 years. I mean, my thing is whenever I get on a novel, and I never knew I would be like this, my MFA, my first book is a collection of stories. And that was primarily what I was doing in my MFA, writing short stories. I didn't know if I'd ever write a novel, but I wanted to try it. And I tried a couple that failed and I didn't finish them and all that. And then once I got into my Sunshine Away and recognized that it was something I was going to finish, since then, the novel form to me has been just more attractive. I like the puzzle of it. I like the long stretch. I'm a person with writing. I'm a person that likes to have a secret, so I don't talk to people about what I'm working on during the process. I like that space of not having any other voices at all in my head when I'm in the middle of something. And what a novel affords you to do is be like that for several years. and that feels good, because I know what I'm doing. And but I don't want someone else to tell me I'm crazy before I prove it myself,
Sure. Well, without talking about it, are you working on another novel now?
I've started on something, but okay. I have no idea. And again, talking about old ideas, this is an idea I had even before the idea for the Big Door Prize, but it's one that has never gone away. And it's one that I always previously felt I wasn't sort of ready to write. And so I'm going to try it. I'm going to try it now. I've got the first chapter. And I hope it's okay, man. But you really never know. That's what I'm saying. It's going to take a long time before I know.
Sure. Well, what novels or nonfiction books have you read recently that you enjoyed?
There's lots. I mean, I'm trying to think of the things that, in terms of like what did I enjoy that ended up sort of influencing this book, I realized a couple years ago or a few years ago that I really like funny novels. And I felt like for most of my schooling, I didn't know I was like allowed to do that. Like I didn't know that funny novels could also be literary. I thought literary fiction had to be very sort of serious all the time. And then, I came across like a book like Richard Russo's Straight Man, right? Which is really well written, but just hilarious. And then I read like The End of Vandalism by Tom Drury, which I found hilarious. I'm trying to think of some of the other just really funny books. I've read recently Stephen Rowley's Lily and the Octopus, which is hilarious and sad. And I started realizing, man, I love it. I love a book that can make me laugh and then also just rip my heart out, right? I mean, anytime they're both doing both of those things, that to me is my favorite reading experience. And probably the most important writer to me is a guy named Lewis Norton from Mississippi, who he died a while ago. But his work does that. And I was always so attracted to his work. And so those are some of the things that really, I think, influence this book. As far as, you know, things I've read lately, I've been lucky enough to be doing book tour stuff and having interviews with other writers. You know, in the Zoom land now, this is how they do book tours. It's interviews. And so I got to read David James Poussin is his full name, his new novel, Lake Life, which I think is great. I got to read The Everlasting by Katie Simpson Smith. I got to read Some Go Home by Odie Lindsay. They're all excellent. And then every once in a while, I like to, you know, I'm on Twitter, you know, unfortunately, it's probably part of the brain damage I have right now. But the good thing about Twitter is that writers talk about other books that they like, right? And so I started hearing about this book called Blacktop Wasteland by a guy named S.A. Cosby. And I don't really read a lot of crime stuff. So I was kind of like, well, I'm just going to check it out. And I thought it was a tremendous book, you know, really great. And it was great to sort of step out of my, you know, normal reading habits and read a crime novel. So I thought that was great. And other than that, I'm typically trying to find something weird every once in a while. You know, like I said, I love my, you know, my Amy Benders and, you know, people like that just don't seem to really have any sort of tether to the reality that most of us do.
Sure. Well, where can people find you online if they want to learn more about you and your novels?
I've got a website. It's my last name is Walsh, WALSH.com. I'm on Twitter at M_O_Walsh. I have a Facebook page. I'm around in all those places.
Great. Well, again, we've been speaking with M.O. Walsh, author of the new novel, The Big Door Prize. The novel is on sale now, so go buy a copy. And M.O., thanks for doing this interview.
Oh, thank you. This is great. When y'all do things like this for writers, you just don't understand how much we appreciate it. Just thank you so much.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. And now stay tuned for a short excerpt from the audiobook of The Big Door Prize by M.O. Walsh, narrated by Sean Pratt. Published by Penguin Audio and available wherever audiobooks are sold.
Through the door walked a man neither Douglas nor Pete immediately recognized. He looked to be from a different era. He had on a cowboy getup, with a big brimmed hat, and his boots clicked the concrete floor as he strutted up to the bar. It was an unnatural walk, there was no doubt about it. His legs were parted in an odd manner, spread a bit too far, as if maybe he was trying to scratch an itch without his hands. He sidled up to the end of the bar and hooked his thumb through his belt loop, did a little scan of the place, and tipped his hat to Cawley, who stood up to greet him.
"Miss Cawley," he said.
"Mayor," she said.
"It's just Hank tonight," Hank told her. "The working day is done."
"That must be nice," she said. When the bar door closed and the dimness returned, both Douglas and Pete recognized that the man was Hank Reshew, and Pete waved him over. Hank obliged.
"Hank," Pete said, "you sure do look festive."
Hank shook his hand.
"Father," he said.
"It's just Pete tonight," Pete said.
"But I have to admit you're making me feel a bit self-conscious. I'm the only guy in here not wearing a hat."
The three men appraised themselves, and this was true. Hank, in his Stetson, Douglas, in his beret, and Pete, there in the middle. They made a little landscape of possibility lined up like that, as if, as a unit, the picture of them could exist nearly anywhere, and at any time in history. Had Deerfield ever held such promise? Who could know?
"You know Doug Hubbard?" Pete asked.
"He teaches history at the school. One of the actual geniuses in this town, from what I hear." Douglas leaned over to shake Hank's hand. He was becoming outwardly drunk, this was obvious, and looked a bit put out at this unexpected amount of social interaction.
"I know Hubbard," Hank said. "Sure shooting."
"I forget that everybody knows everybody here," Pete said. "Or," Douglas said, as if making a profound statement, "they like to think they do.
Hank pulled a coin out of his pocket and tapped it on the bar. "So, what are you fellers drinking tonight?" he said. "I need a suggestion."
"I, for one, recommends alcohol," Douglas said. From her stool, without looking up, Callie said, "I second that."
"Hubbard," Hank said, "you teach history, right? I have a question for you. How about you tell me what kind of drink would be historically accurate for a cowboy to order?"
Douglas felt his teacher mode coming on again. Was even the mayor a witless victim of that stupid DNA machine, which Douglas had been privately stewing about the past hour? Could that account for his ridiculous new accent? His asinine hat?
"Why do you ask, Hank?" Douglas said. "Are you suddenly under the insane impression that you're meant to be a cowboy?"
"No," Hank said, although the way he said this made it obvious that this was perhaps the exact impression he was under.
"I've just taken an interest, is all. Call it historical curiosity."
"Well," Douglas said, "I don't know how to answer your question, since the term cowboy isn't really a historical reference. I mean, it's not a time period, Hank. It's a person's occupation."
"That's true," Pete said, and trying to get Collie's attention by clinking around the ice in his glass.
"You know what I mean, though," Hank said. "Real cowboys. Wild West types. True grit. A fistful of ugly. The fast and the furious. All that stuff."
"Can I have another one of those soda waters, Miss Callie?" Pete said.
"Just like I made it before?" she asked.
"Please," Pete said, and laid another 10 on the bar.
"That's some expensive soda water," Hank said.
"Charity," Pete said, before the need for it.
"Well," Douglas said, "a fistful of dollars is said in the 1870s or so."
"Is it?"
Hank said. "It takes place during the Civil War," Douglas told him. "That's a major part of the movie. That's not hard to remember."
"A war amongst ourselves," Hank said. "What a dadgum tragedy."
"Amen to that," Pete said, and lifted his empty glass. "Never again."
This is Derek's O'Reilly Auto Parts story.
After the third time jump-starting my car, I finally realized my battery was dying. So I stopped by O'Reilly to have it checked. They tested it right there in the parking lot. It was bad, real bad. But they helped me find the right battery for my car and even installed it for free. Now my car starts like new.
Oh, O'Reilly Auto Parts.